saw and heard things that weren't there. I was very aggressive and hostile. I even had a cognitive impairment where I struggled finding words. My gait was affected. My eyesight was affected. And he spent about an hour in my room. And at one point, he came up with the idea to ask me to draw a clock, which is a pretty typical test, but mostly given to Alzheimer's and stroke patients. And I drew that clock lopsided. One side was completely missing.
Dear Family is a podcast hosted by Rachel Steinman, a writer, an educator, and a mental health advocate. And Rachel gets us up close and personal, so we feel a strong connection, familiarity, and comfort with her guests. So settle in and join us as we search for true healing and journey with Rachel and her most interesting guests.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Dear Family, the podcast. We all thought that 2021 was going to be different, but I really do think that we needed to hit the rock bottom, and I'm not that surprised, to be honest, the way things were headed. When our Capitol was stormed by hateful mobsters, it was truly heartbreaking, and it will always be. But I don't want to forget that it was the same day that a Black man and a Jewish man were named Georgia's senators in the Deep South. We are still in the dark days of winter and COVID numbers are high, but be hopeful because the light, it's just about to emerge. In fact, in one more week and a day, to be specific, if you're listening as this publishes, because that's when we have our inauguration. If you've been following me on my Right Now Rachel on Instagram or Facebook, you've noticed that I've been counting down to my 50th birthday, and it's a podcast and an essay that I plan to publish next week. Put it this way, it's not the Oprah 50th birthday celebration with celebrities and world-class musicians and party planners in a room full of my dear family and friends drinking Cristal, because obviously of where we are right now with COVID, and I live in Los Angeles where the numbers are insane high. So clearly it's not going to be the celebration that I had always dreamed of back when I had a toddler on my lap and watching Oprah, but the lessons remain the same and I'm going to celebrate, and I hope you'll join me. Thank you also for listening and following and subscribing to Dear Family and also sharing it with your dear friends and family. It means so much. Thank you for following me on all the social media platforms at Right Now Rachel. That's right with a W. Please reach out if you have any questions or comments or just want to chat, and take care of yourself. It's really important to look after your mental health, especially right now. Sending lots of love. Enjoy this episode. Susanna Cahalan tells the astonishing true story of her descent into madness, her family's inspiring faith in her, and the life-saving diagnosis that nearly did not happen. Her New York Times bestselling book, Brain on Fire, was adapted for a movie starring Chloe Grace Moretz as her, and it's an unforgettable exploration of memory and identity, faith and love, and a profoundly compelling tale of survival and perseverance. She was a very healthy young person when she was working at the New York Post, and she began having grand mal seizures and babbling, and her increasing paranoia and her seizures, they were misdiagnosed by a neurologist as her just partying too hard combined with stress. And eventually she'd become catatonic, trapped in her body, unable to speak, write, or get thoughts out. Susanna was diagnosed with a schizoaffective disorder with a video of her in the hospital, and it's heartbreaking as it captures her real panic as she's hallucinating that she's on the news while using the remote to try to call for help. After many misdiagnoses and on the verge of being locked up in a psych ward, a miracle doctor comes along and asks her to draw a clock. After a brain biopsy and a spinal tap, she's diagnosed with autoimmune encephalitis, a medical explanation pretending to be psychiatric. Her personal experience leads her deeper into the study of other, quote, great pretenders, the same name as her second New York Times bestselling book. She'd blow the lid on a groundbreaking 1973 study called On Being Sane in Insane Places that rocked the psychiatric world and still does. Susanna lives in Brooklyn with her husband and twin toddlers. You are going to love this episode. Susanna, I read your book in a memoir writing class. I couldn't put it down. It's so riveting and in the mental health space and something I'm so interested in. The moment when everything changed for you was not necessarily when you got sick, but when the doctor had you draw the clock. And we're going to get to that in a second. I've since listened to your NPR Fresh Air interview. I've watched your TED video. I've watched a Netflix adaptation, Brain on Fire, which I loved with Chloe Grace Moretz. I also read your latest book, The Great Pretender. And one other thing I've done is I make these lists. I've done three so far of the best memoirs I've read that really help you get on the inside of understanding mental health issues and substance abuse issues. And both of your books made my list. So to say I'm thrilled to have you is an understatement.
Oh,
so
my
thank
gosh.
You.
Thank you so much for that introduction. I am so curious about the memoir writing class. It's such an honor to hear that my book was taught. It's one of those things where I think while I was writing the book, I could never have imagined that happening. It makes me feel very good.
I just want to say welcome. Thank you so much for being here.
Well, thank you so much for having me. This is just really exciting. I love the concept of looking at mental health through families. It's so important. You think about what you've inherited, what's in your DNA, what's in your environment, and how those things, even in a kind of quote-unquote organic illness, how those also have an effect. It's a really interesting perspective.
Thank you for saying that. Why don't we start by having you tell us a little bit about yourself and about your family?
Sure. I'm turning 36 in this month. My whole family, actually. My husband's born January 21st. I have twins. They're both born January 11th. And I'm born January 31st. So we're all 10 days apart in January. So January is a big month for us here. I'm a writer. I started out as a reporter for the New York Post. Now I write many things, but mostly I focus on narrative nonfiction. I'm just trying to keep going during this very strange time.
Where are you recording from? What part of the world?
I'm based in Brooklyn right now.
You have twins. How old are they?
They're going to turn two on Monday.
Oh my gosh. Thank you. And God bless you for taking the time to sit and speak with me. How are you surviving with twins during a pandemic?
It hasn't been easy. I will say that. Luckily, my husband's like a real co-parent. And recently I've had childcare help, which allows me to do work because otherwise with twins, even with me and my husband dealing with them equally, it's just overwhelming. I was getting zero work done.
I mean, you're still in the diaper phase.
Yes.
I mean,
it's intense. It's so all-consuming. Even if I could have talked to myself when I was pregnant or before and kind of, this is what your life will be like, I don't think I could have properly prepared myself for it.
The kids will get to a certain age where they'll keep each other busy and everyone will be jealous of you. So that's coming.
I see glimmers of that.
But
in the morning, they still wake up so early. They're like up at 5:30 in the morning, but they'll kind of play with each other in the morning and I can actually drink a cup of coffee and maybe read a paper or something. That's a joy.
Susanna, by trade, you're a writer and a journalist and a reporter, but the subject of writing about mental health, which brought you two New York Times bestsellers, was thrust upon you. And you were only 24. Tell us what happened in 2009.
It started kind of innocuously. My environment was, for lack of a better word, was really frenetic. I was working at the New York Post, just graduated. It was my dream job to work there. And I started as an intern. So I was very excited. I had these assignments that would take me all over the city, sometimes all over the country, doing everything from celebrity style pieces to more hard hitting breaking news. And so every day was different. It was unusual and exciting, nerve wracking, stressful. So I think it took me a long time to figure out something was happening internally to me because my external world was so in flux. But really started with feelings of mono. I felt really depressed. I felt kind of wayward and lost. And also kind of physically run down. Like everyone, I've gone through periods in my life where I've had those experiences, where I've gone through a more depressive side of my personality. And I thought maybe it was a phase. And then it started to get worse. And there were some other physical symptoms. I had some numbness in my hands and my feet. I had some migraines. And then quickly from there, it escalated very fast. And I started to have very extreme fluctuations in my mood. It would go from my moments of crying hysterically to then being overjoyed, this manic joy, very rapidly cycling. So it would happen over a period of minutes. That was the precursor to a full-blown break, which manifested in psychosis. I saw and heard things that weren't there. I was very aggressive and hostile. I even had a cognitive impairment where I struggled finding words. My gait was affected. My eyesight was affected. And that escalated once more. And then I had my first seizure, and through various machinations from my parents, who were really advocated for me, I was able to get to a hospital where I was diagnosed with an autoimmune disease of my brain. After being misdiagnosed repeatedly, first with bipolar disorder, and then later with schizoaffective disorder.
You basically were this healthy person who suddenly had grand mal seizures and all these psychiatric disorders. And you were so paranoid that you thought your father was going to murder your stepmom. And you believed you could age people. I've dealt a little bit with psychosis with my mom, who has bipolar. And as a family member, it's so frightening to see someone believe these thoughts that aren't real. And I know you began speaking incomprehensible phrases. It does sound very scary for you and for your then boyfriend and your family and your coworkers. What was it like? Did you feel like you were trapped? Were you able to get any words out?
It's so hard because of the time that has passed, but also because I've written about it, talked about it. There was a movie about it. Yeah. There's so many layers of artifice now on top of that time. But what is helpful to me is that on some level, I knew I was going to write about this. And before I really embarked on that, I had a journal and I wrote down what I could remember. In the beginning, it was frustrating more than anything else. I felt confused. Like, why am I acting this way? When I had some clarity, I think it's important to note, not just in autoimmune encephalitis, but in mental health issues in general, someone who is, let's say, dealing with bipolar disorder, they don't have manic episodes all the time or depressive episodes all the time. There are vast moments of clarity, even with some kind of illnesses with a psychosis element. Someone is not psychotic all the time. And that was true with my experience as well, especially in the beginning. As I became more and more impaired, my memory is very unreliable. But in the beginning, I just remember feeling like I was trying to puzzle it together and trying to make sense. I was crying. Why was I crying? I don't know. And then I look at my life and I think, well, I'm 24. I'm in this new environment. I'm in the city all by myself. I have a new relationship. I have a very stressful job. XYZ. Maybe I said something I didn't mean and I embarrassed myself. And that was a reason, or I messed up on a story. So I could make these kind of reasons. When the manic side, when I was overjoyed, I didn't want to explain it. I actually very much enjoyed that. I was filled with energy and all this motivation to do all this work. And I didn't think of that. I didn't try to piece that apart, but it was really the kind of despair that really bothered me. And I tried to figure it out, tried to explain what is going on with me. And that question was really painful. And I imagine is very painful for people dealing with all kinds of illnesses, mental health issues. The overwhelming part of it was the confusion, the anger, frustration.
You were diagnosed with a schizoaffective disorder because of your moods and your thoughts. Were you able to advocate at that point for yourself when you were meeting with doctors?
No. My first diagnosis was bipolar disorder, and that was before my hospitalization. I went to a neurologist who misdiagnosed me and actually attributed some of it to alcohol withdrawal, which was a misreading of an interview. He asked me how much you were drinking a day. I said about 2 glasses of wine, and he had written down 2 bottles of wine.
Oh,
so he obviously had painted a whole portrait of my lifestyle and who I was. I think it was kind of a square peg round hole situation where he was thinking, okay, this woman is behaving in all these different ways, these seizures, et cetera. I can't explain it because I don't have the knowledge to figure this out. So let me just like kind of ram her into this category of that would explain it. And I think that's what happened, but that followed me. Initially, when I was undergoing this frustrating question of why am I behaving this way? What's wrong with me? I went to Dr. Google and came to the conclusion that I had bipolar disorder. So I actually concluded that before the doctor did, and then a doctor confirmed that diagnosis. And I felt such relief to get that diagnosis because it explained the mood swings. It explained the despair. It explained all these things that I couldn't understand. And I also knew that there was this long pedigree of very famous writers and thinkers and creators who have that diagnosis. So I felt like I was part of some kind of club and it felt very reassuring. It wasn't the real reason, but I remember at the time feeling a lot of relief when I got that diagnosis. So then later,
as the illness progressed and my psychosis became more apparent, I was saying to doctors that I had multiple personality disorder. So I was actually doing the opposite of advocating for myself to kind of push for other answers to what was happening.
When you were in the hospital, you were psychotic and having hallucinations. There's an actual very haunting video of you. You're on the EEG floor, and I'm going to link it in the show notes because it's just very fascinating to see for anyone that's interested. But you're hallucinating that you're on the news, and we watch you in full-blown panic mode, trying to use the remote to call somebody. And we feel that you are really, truly seeing this and believing this. When was the first time you were able to watch that back? And what was that like for you?
It took me a while to actually get those videos because the videos belong to the hospital. And so to get my medical records and then get the video footage from my hospitalization, it took a lot of wrangling because I think they were scared of a lawsuit or something. I don't know, but it really was hard. And I think I've talked to a lot of patients who want to write about their experiences, and they hit walls because doctors don't want to give up the medical records. Luckily, my doctor, Dr. Najjar, advocated for me to get the medical records, and eventually I did, and eventually I got the videos. And so it took me so long to get them, and then it took me a long time to watch them. The first time I watched that video was probably in the New York Post newsroom when I had written the article about my experience. They wanted some kind of picture of me in the hospital because, you know, it's a tabloid newspaper, they want it. And I got at least one of the videos at that point from my doctor, and it was that video. And I remember he opened it up. It was in the center of the newsroom, you know, bustling with activity. And I kind of watched part of it, and it was overwhelming because even by that point, I had done some preliminary reporting to write an article about my experience and still had distance from it because I couldn't remember so much about it. And I still had this reporter journalistic approach where I was like, the worse it was, the better, because it was a better story. But then seeing me go through this extremely frightening experience, like, we don't have documents of our fear. We don't take pictures of ourselves being scared typically, but to have this document of like really bona fide, real fear of something that was imaginary, it was in my head, was really disturbing. And I think it broke down a lot of walls that I had put up of a distance between the Susanna of that I was writing about and me myself, which I definitely at various points, there is a complete wall between those two people. And so seeing me enact that, I couldn't pretend that it was another person. My mind couldn't actually separate anymore. It was really overwhelming. And I think it took months before I actually watched any of the videos again.
How many years later was that when you watched it in the room?
It wasn't even a year later. I know that it was New York Post, I remember.
That's amazing.
It must have been then, because it was when I wrote the piece, and I wrote the piece within a year of getting diagnosed.
Incredible, Susanna. My brother, Adam, at one point was addicted to crystal meth, and he became homeless. Very happy ending. He's married and has a successful business, but he was lucky because he had a loving family to catch him. You've said the same, that you were very lucky to have a family that was there to catch you, and your boyfriend, who had become your husband, was also there. There's another side of your luck, and that was Dr. Najjar. And he, maybe it was luck, maybe it was impeccable timing, we don't know. But he was this clinician and a researcher, and he showed up in your life right before you were going to be put into a mental health hospital, potentially, quote unquote, locked up for the rest of your life. Tell us about this miracle doctor and why everything changed when you drew that clock.
Dr. Najjar is an amazing person and has a really incredible backstory. He's Syrian American. So he was born in Syria, Damascus. As a young child, was misdiagnosed. So he went through a long illness as a child, and also lost in his school system in a private school, and was at the bottom of his class, probably because he was not doing well physically, and was basically kicked out of the school and told he's not an academic, he's not smart enough, he should learn something else, figure something else out. And he ended up going to the public school, and a teacher really saw him and believed in him. He flourished and graduated top of his class and ended up going to medical school there, and then various specialties, including epilepsy, immunology, among other specializations that he has, and is now considered one of the best neurologists in this country. He has this amazing backstory, and I think part of it is he really values listening to his patients. And that's a hard thing to do within the hospital system, especially now.
But even then, you know, doctors don't have time and these billable hours, it's impossible. You get 15 minutes with the patient. And obviously, insurance companies don't value the time it takes to really put into figuring out difficult to diagnose cases. And even cases that are simple to diagnose, it takes a while. Each person is unique and their experience of illness is unique. It takes a long time. He is really a testament to old school clinical care, which is using all of your senses to really listen to a patient. In my case, I couldn't speak for myself. By the time he came in, I was catatonic. I was pretty mute, barely moving at that point. I couldn't read or write. I could barely swallow liquids on my own. He was using his interactions with my parents, who were there every day. He was the first person who really sat down and listened to them and heard the story from their perspective. And I know this because I have the medical records. And interestingly, out of everyone, he was the only one to handwrite his notes. I don't think he does it anymore because that was a transition period. But his notes were all handwritten. There were 3 pages of notes. And in there, you see kind of the full spectrum of the illness. Mm-hmm. Whereas each doctor who's specializing in a certain area of the body was focusing on this or that. Like the cardiologist focusing on the heart. The rheumatologist was focusing on the lab tests. You had people looking at everything piecemeal, psychiatrist looking at the behavior, and no one was putting it all together until he came along. And part of that is like he really listened to my parents, and then he really listened to me in terms of saw me fully and really experienced what was going on with me. And he spent about an hour in my room. And at one point, he came up with the idea to ask me to draw a clock, which is a pretty typical test, but mostly given to Alzheimer's and stroke patients. And I drew that clock lopsided. One side was completely missing. And that became one of the keys to showing him that we're not dealing most likely with the psychiatric conditions. These labels are arbitrary, I think, in a lot of ways. But for him, that clock pushed him to say, okay, we need to dig deeper. So that was a turning point.
Thank goodness for Dr. Najjar. He convinced your parents to do a spinal tap and a biopsy of your brain, and they diagnosed you with autoimmune encephalitis. What was the treatment?
The treatment was initially with steroids intravenously, and then I had plasmapheresis, which is removing the plasma from your blood, basically essentially washing it of these harmful antibodies, because in the case of autoimmune diseases, rogue antibodies basically start to attack the brain. And in my case, these receptors in the brain called the NMDA receptor. So in plasmapheresis, they kind of wash your blood of those bad antibodies.
Right? Not MM. NM.
NM. NM. Right. I've made that mistake in the past, but yeah. I'm not having ecstasy in my brain.
Right.
Yes. So yeah. And then I also had IVIG, which is when there's donor antibodies that are flushed into the system as well. So that was the process. They're intense procedures, but it's fairly common within the autoimmune world. Anyone who deals with an autoimmune illness will recognize all of those elements. Today, this was 10 years ago, but today, if I would have gotten sick, they probably would have put a chemotherapy drug as well into that mix because they want to suppress the immune system from making those bad antibodies, basically.
Fascinating. Thank God for modern medicine, honestly. And you used your journalistic skills to go back and reconstruct the story, and you had videos and you had your journals and your dad's journals. But as a memoirist, what was it like interviewing your parents after the fact?
They're very different people. So I had to deploy different tactics to interviewing them. My mom was of the kind of school of, I'm going to pretend nothing bad happens. So in my mind, it wasn't that bad. You weren't that sick. We always knew you were going to be fine. Every time I interviewed her, I'd have to bring my huge medical record pile with me and lay out what the doctors were saying. And then she'd cry and the defenses would come down. It's terrible. I'm totally, you know,
manipulating. No, I get it. I mean, I think moms do that. We want to see.
It's a trauma response.
It's a trauma response.
Yeah. And I think her background, her father died very young. That goes into it probably.
Right.
But that's her way of dealing with trauma, is to mitigate it. Now, it was infuriating for me, especially when I was recovering, because she wasn't really acknowledging how bad it was for me because she didn't want to believe it herself. So it was very hard for me. But I understand now with some perspective that she was doing it to protect herself and to protect me because she had to be strong for me. So I understand now. But at the time, it was frustrating because I didn't feel validated in some ways. Now, my father had the exact
opposite response. He overplayed how bad it was. In his mind, I was in the hospital for 3 months. I was in the hospital for only 1 month. Every time I would bring things up, he would cry. So I could only talk to him over the phone. We couldn't do it in person. I wouldn't show him medical records because he would fall apart. So it was just two very different ways of dealing with these interviews, which were just very odd because, again, I'm the subject of these interviews. You can't even try to be objective. It's obviously very subjective. And you're asking someone to speak honestly and openly about you, which is never an easy thing to do anyway, but especially if you've just recovered, because at that point I was still recovering really while I was writing the book. It was a real exercise in trying to pull out as much of even the bad stuff. Tell me how bad. I behaved very negatively and there were embarrassing moments throughout. Especially during the height of my psychosis. It was hard to get them to talk about. It was painful, but also bringing up hard topics in families are never easy anyway.
Oh. And it's interesting what I've learned is sometimes you need a little time and space between something to really understand it. So I wonder if you were to go back to them 10 years later and do the same interviews, I bet things would be a little different, which is one of the challenges of writing memoir. Your quality of care drastically improved when the doctors labeled you with a medical diagnosis as opposed to a psychiatric one. I'm just wondering why you think that psychiatric disorders don't get as much compassion or care or sympathy.
In my specific case, we'll speak specifically and then generally, I think that once that they realized, oh, she's a unicorn or a zebra, as they call these rare illnesses, there was an excitement. There's something we can do. We can look at her brain. We can give her the steroids and then maybe we can cure her of this. It was this idea of she's rare. At that time, I was 217th person in the world to have this diagnosis. Mm. So I was called an interesting case by everyone and all the student doctors were coming in, getting taught my illness.
That's
and I was like a lab
rat.
Oh yeah, it was terrible. At one point, one of the doctors in front of his student army basically said, oh, and there is a big chance, because at the time this is true, it's not true anymore, but in some cases there is something called a teratoma, which is a mass in the ovaries, which can be the instigator of the illness, because sometimes that mass has brain matter, which will confuse the body into making these antibodies that will then somehow get across the blood-brain barrier and into the brain. So he said, we might have to remove her ovaries. That was the first time anyone had heard that.
You're just listening to this and having all these faces stare back at you.
Oh. Dad told him to get the F out of the room. He was so mad because how dare you introduce that possibility with a room full of strangers and then also without any bedside manner. And
but
so,
that's
you know,
the doctor's ego, unfortunately, but
So, and I think what we're talking about, which was your original question, which was, why was I treated differently? I think a little bit was doctor's ego. I think there was an excitement, like, we can cure her. This is an opportunity. Whereas I think they see the long haul of dealing with a chronic psychiatric illness. There isn't a magic bullet for that. There are, for some people, medications that work wonders, but there is not plasmapheresis for schizophrenia. That excitement about the newness and the possibilities there changed the level of care for sure in that specific case. Yeah.
Yeah. Your autoimmune encephalitis was a great pretender because it pretended to be psychiatric, like paranoia, mood disorders, jealousy, and inappropriate behaviors, and eventually catatonia. But it also manifested in physical things, like you had migraines and you ended up having
seizures,
right? I know that there are other great pretenders like Lyme, syphilis, lupus, something called PANDAS, which I also learned about, which parents, if you're listening, you should know about it. It stands for Pediatric Autoimmune Neuropsychiatric Disorders Associated with Strep. If your kid has strep, or you might not even know they had strep, and then they suddenly start dealing with OCD or acting out, they may have this great pretender. And I just want to tell you a quick story about my daughter, Molly, who was just 5 years old when we went to Martha's Vineyard and she got bit by a tick. We saw the bullseye and she had her 3 weeks of antibiotics. 6 months later, started acting really not herself. And as a mom, we know, she was only six at the time, we know when our kids aren't acting normally.
How was she behaving?
She was lying. She was really moody. She also had some physical things too. She was complaining about her joints hurting and her toes swelled up. And the doctors said, no, 3 weeks of antibiotics is all you needed. And oh no, it's just growing pains, but I listened to my mother's intuition and I found a doctor that was actually an eye doctor, but had done her research. I live in Los Angeles. We don't have a lot of Lyme here, especially then. This was in 2011. And basically, she was put on 2 different antibiotics for 6 months, and we changed her diet to a gluten sugar-free diet because of the antibiotics. But thank God she's okay now. That's a long way to get to this question, but what can happen when your body's immune system attacks itself?
I think we're just at the cusp of understanding that. It can be very diffuse. The more we understand about the role that different cells, different parts of the brain interact with the body, the more we realize it can be anything, really. There's a wonderful book about microglia in the brain called The Angel and the Assassin. Microglia can affect everything from depression, can have an effect on memory loss, Alzheimer's, even hunger. All these things are mitigated by the brain-body connections. If there are cells in the brain that can affect that connection and affect parts of the brain, who knows? We are just at the beginning of understanding that connection and understanding what happens when that connection gets severed or disrupted in some way.
I'm so grateful that you're bringing this to the public so that people can consider it. There are 50 million people with an autoimmune disease, and 75% of them are women. It could be because of hormones or because our immune system's more complex because of carrying fetuses. Did you have any issues or any concerns with twins and all the hormones?
I was very, very lucky, I have to say.
Oh, good.
I didn't really have any complications with my pregnancy, but though I did have complications with my delivery unrelated to anything else, which still showed me how women are treated differently in medicine and in hospital settings. So in my case, I had a C-section because I went to 38 weeks. I was huge. I was enormous. And I'm very lucky because they were both very healthy. But what happened was I had the C-section, and unbeknownst to anyone else, I had a blockage. And so my stomach started to distend. It got as big as when I was pregnant. It was filled with air. And it was so painful. It felt like someone stabbed me in the stomach. And I was complaining about the pain. And the doctors and nurse's assistant really discounted my pain and said straight up, "You're complaining because of the surgery." One of them said, "Have you never gotten surgery before?" My husband's like, "She had brain surgery, you know?" And I had my appendix out. I'm no stranger to pain, but I passed out from the pain. My blood pressure went sky high. And because you're in the bureaucracy of the hospital, what happens is outside of your control, you get immediately put on a magnesium drip. And one of the nurses was like, "Do not put her on a magnesium drip." She was advocating for me, but they wouldn't listen to her. So I was put on a magnesium drip. And magnesium drips basically incapacitate you. I started slurring. Stephen had all this PTSD from being in the hospital, and I was like cognitively impaired. And I'm getting worse and worse and worse. I start projectile vomiting bile. I can't eat anything. It was terrible. And meanwhile, they're discounting and discounting. I'm getting further into the bureaucracy and the maze of the hospital system. And at one point they're saying they're going to put an endoscopy thing. And it was getting worse and worse and worse. And one of the nurses said, "I think she has this thing that I've only seen once. And I think she has this blockage." The attendant would not consider it. She kept me on that magnesium drip. Eventually it got so bad that they finally did an x-ray of my stomach and found the blockage. It's called an ileus, thanks to this nurse. And the worst thing you can be is on a magnesium drip for that, because the only way to clear it is to walk around. Almost everyone who gives birth, you know, bumps up against the bureaucracy, but also the way women's pain is kind of discounted. That was really frustrating for me and Stephen. We have so much knowledge in this area, and yet we still ended up in the same place. It was just a wild experience for sure.
Thank goodness for our nurses.
No, nurses are key.
They're angels.
It's so funny. Like, a lot of doctors I've talked to always says, like, the motto is don't mess with nurses because they run the hospital.
Yes, I agree with that. Your personal experience with a great pretender diagnosis led you deeper into researching mental health and the history of it. And that was your second book. I loved The Great Pretender. And in The Great Pretender, you talk about this groundbreaking 1973 study called On Being Sane in Insane Places, which is about a Stanford psychologist named David Rosenhan. And he, along with 7 other sane people, volunteered to get put into a psychiatric ward by repeating the same 3 words, thud, empty, hollow. And that was all it took. And they got put away. A lot of this study was how difficult it was for them to get out. Why did it rock the psychiatric world at the time.
You have to go back to 1973 and what was going on in psychiatry at the time. Like, psychiatry was going through a major crisis. So it was moving away from Freud. Freud was still the predominant way of viewing mental health conditions. It was in the process of moving away from that as we've discovered Thorazine and lithium and other psychiatric medication, which made it diagnosis very important because you had to tell a difference between what was schizophrenia and what was bipolar disorder to give the proper medication. This premium on diagnosis runs up right against Freud, who does not care about diagnosis at all. And so there was this push to let's medicalize psychiatry. Psychiatry was kind of the purview of more humanities. It was a bona fide medical specialty, but there was a lot of magical thinking going on. The idea of trying to cement it down in with the rest of medicine, which was going from expanding leaps and bounds at that point. There was a heart transplant around that time. We're really figuring out the body. And so the mind became this, and it still is, this final frontier. And so there's a really big push to push psychiatry into the rest of medicine. When this study came out, it was really embarrassing for psychiatry in general because what happened was these eight people just said, thud empty hollow, and all of them were diagnosed with serious mental illness in almost all cases with schizophrenia, just based on that one symptom, I hear a voice that says thud empty hollow. And they were in the hospital from anywhere from 7 to 52 days without being detected as quote unquote, as the author says, sane, which are not terms that we use or they use. Really then. It was a black eye for psychiatry. It showed, okay, we don't know the difference between someone who's mentally ill, mentally well, and also our mental hospitals are essentially places that don't heal. In fact, some cases they actually harm. A lot of the experiences of the pseudo patients were extremely negative, watching verbal and physical abuse, feeling, as they described, as a nether person, so as a less than human. This study not only hit on psychiatry as a field, but in hospitals as well. And the popular culture was right on board. That was the era of One Flew Over of the Cuckoo's Nest and Snake Pit and tons of journalistic exposés on mistreatment in psychiatric hospitals. It fit right into that movement at the time and continues to have an immense effect on psychiatry today. Any history of psychiatry that you pick up will mention this study at one point. Most intro to psych courses talk about this study that continued to this day, even though it's an old study at this point, but it's still really a powerful one. It was the imagery, really evocatively written, but also on some fundamental truths that we do separate out mental illnesses as being somehow less legitimate or less worthy of our sympathy, respect, and money than physical illnesses. There was some truth there that is still true.
As far as historically, it was probably responsible for getting rid of a lot of the big psychiatric wards, which my grandparents had been in, and back then were called insane asylums. But now I think the pendulum is swinging to the point where we need places to help our mentally ill. That's a whole other conversation. Rosenhan died a year before you had the opportunity to interview him. You'd end up going down a rabbit hole of real journalistic endeavor, and you discovered his personal notes. You had the opportunity to interview living pseudo patients. Can you tell us what you uncovered?
In the course of 6 years of diving into this study, because I was a fan, I saw myself in some of the descriptions, and I saw even the brief mistreatment or just a kind of change in my treatment once it became a bodily issue, a neurological issue versus the psychiatric. These questions really haunted me. I butted up against this where I actually did presentations in psychiatric hospitals. And in one case, there was a woman who was properly diagnosed after my presentation, but she would never recover. Her brain had gone through too much trauma to recover fully. There's high stakes to getting these things wrong. So why does psychiatry get them so wrong? These are the questions that animated me. I wanted to learn more about the study. The author, David Rosenhan, had passed away. I found an unpublished book. I found his papers. I found his diary. And I was able to start trying to piece this all together. And bit by bit, it started to unravel. And I realized that so much of this paper, which had this huge effect on psychiatry, not only how psychiatry saw itself, but how outsiders saw psychiatry. And bit by bit, I realized a lot of this was embellished. A lot of this was full-blown made up. And I started to doubt how many of the participants that he wrote about actually existed. Now, it took me a long time to get there because wow. I really was a fan of the study. This was a kind of education for me, A, about, you know, fraud and academia and science,
but also about how sometimes we have good intentions, but they can lead us down really dark paths. What you had gestured to before about how some of the quote unquote insane asylums of your ancestors that were in, they don't exist anymore. And thank God, because they were snake pits, hell holes, not beneficial healing environments, but nothing came to replace them. What we have is a situation where a lot of people who are very, very sick and would benefit from care, some long-term care, some short-term care, some various interventions are not getting help. And that's just a fact. And our mental health care system is broken in this country. And this study happened to have a huge effect on that and continues to. In fact, I was just sent a study, a paper, I think it was in some academic, I can't remember exactly where, but they still referenced that study as being this glorious, insightful study. And I think I wrote a whole book dedicated to showing that this is not, so it still has not fully penetrated. I hope that it does get out there. I hope it doesn't remove the study from the conversation, because there are some truths in that study, but I hope it does change the way people teach it and discuss it.
How amazing. I'm sure it's weird for you to think about, but you are going to be included in those textbooks as someone that continue to change that history and expose. And also, you are able to have other people be aware of the brain-body connection. I'm very grateful to you. You should take a little pat on the back. Oh. Good job. I want to go back to the idea of some of those things that you experienced, like the grandiosity and the violence. And I think you may have mentioned that you were hypersexual and you were doing these guttural sounds. And any other time in history had this happened, you could have been burned at the stake or exorcised, or at the very least ended up in one of these psych wards. What a blessing to now be able to spread this message that your story can lead others to do further tests and hopefully be helped and potentially cured. Has anything come out of The Great Pretender? What's the next chapter for you?
I leave The Great Pretender open-ended in terms of how much of this was made up. I hope that I would hear from participants to tell me, you're wrong, it is true. And I haven't yet. In fact, right. I've only gotten confirmation that from people who knew him that I was on the right track with it. Mm. There's actually a push right now from various ethicists, mostly at UPenn, but now at Columbia, who want to actually have the paper retracted from Science from where it was originally published, which is very gratifying to me, even though I feel conflicted about retracting it, because I still have a fondness for the study. In terms of my next steps, I'm very interested in mind and body, and I've actually been very interested in psychedelics. Not personally, I'm too scared, but I'm just interested in that in the culture, because I think it's going to have a huge place in the culture as we get closer and closer to FDA approval, especially of the use of mushrooms in clinical care. I want to know what are the stakes there and what are the potentials. Right now, I'm working on a new book that looks at that through the lens of this forgotten woman who was involved with the psychedelic revolution, and she never had her story told. I want to look into what are the potentials and limitations, and also what is the female psychedelic experience? We hear it so often through the male gaze, but what is it like to have that transcendental experience, but as a woman? What are the drawbacks for women too?
I will definitely be reading that. So great. I saw your syllabus you were coming up with for a mental health narrative class. And besides your two books, which I would definitely have on there, what's one book that you suggest we all should read to get on the inside? Or what was a book that you taught your class that struck a chord with everyone?
I loved so many of these books so much. So it was hard for me. Some of them I read for the first time for the class, but the two that were the most loved was Perks of Being a Wallflower. We did that for our PTSD class, which really resonated with the kids. Unsurprisingly, it feels very authentic. And even though it's fiction, most of what we read was nonfiction. One of my personal favorites was Bassi Iqbi's book, I'm Telling the Truth, I'm Lying, which is about her experience with bipolar 2. And it is really beautifully written, very honest. She shows it all. It's one of the most powerful depictions. And the students agreed. They loved that book so much. According to the students themselves, those two were the winners. My personal favorite didn't make it into the students' top. Some of the students loved it. Some of the students, I think, found it a little bit more challenging because he draws in a lot of history. was Scott Stossel's The Age of Anxiety, which is just a beautiful piece of work that he brings in so much. I mean, literary references, historical references, and really grounds anxiety, which is something we can all relate to. But his experience of anxiety is very extreme. And you start to realize I overuse that term when we actually talk about a clinical diagnosis of anxiety. It's a very different thing than what I experience of anxiety, but it's still universal. So it's just a really brilliant book.
Oh, it sounds so good. Last two questions that I ask all my guests. When you were 20 years old, you're at WashU in St. Louis. Thinking back, if you could write yourself a Dear Susanna love letter, knowing what you know now, what would you have told yourself?
I would say, do not worry about your weight. Oh my God, the amount of time and energy I've spent thinking about what I was putting in my mouth and how much I weighed when I was like, had a little thin body. I should have enjoyed that body, you know. Really, that was stupid. I would have said, stop smoking. I smoked then. And I would have said, take challenging classes. Who cares about your GPA? Take that philosophy, neuroscience classes that you were too scared to take. Just do it.
Is there anything that you do that brings you a lot of joy?
Reading brings me a lot of joy. And the babies bring me a lot of joy. But I really miss my morning rituals. I'm very ritualistic with writing, but also just in terms of my day. And so I used to have a whole ritual. For a period of time, I was drinking matcha. And so I'd have this whole ritual of making the matcha. And then I'd have this certain papers that I would read. And it would be this whole morning. I don't have that anymore, but I have glimmers of it here and there. That makes me so happy when I'm really in a place of writing every day and a lack of chaos, which I sometimes bring in the chaos and I let the chaos go. I do a lot of meditation. And that, even though it's very challenging for me, the challenge brings me happiness. Writing was very challenging for me, but when I'm doing it every day and it brings me happiness. So I'm actually a little bit out of my writing habit right now. So I'm feeling a little lost. So I just have to know, okay, it's painful, but it will make you happier.
You have to give yourself a little compassion and space. You have twins and what's happening in our world right now.
It's my time to be alone. It's one of those things where it's hard for me to get started, but when I'm doing it, time goes and it's a joy and a struggle.
Yeah. I love the idea of making the matcha. For me, it's my morning cup of coffee. Yeah. It's so amazing to me, the joy that my coffee brings me.
One of the best things I did for myself this year was I bought myself a frother. It's not the hand one. I like a real froth. It's actually a machine. You put the milk in.
You can make little drinks for your kids. That's so great. Well, I want to thank you so much for being my guest on Dear Family. I'm so grateful to people like you that are bringing awareness to others of the importance of understanding that our mental health is just as important as our physical health, and also the connection between brain and body and brain and mood. It's so good to have these conversations so that someone else can tell their sister or their brother or their mom, maybe we need to dig deeper and just keep it up. I can't wait to read your book on psychedelics.
Thank you. I can't wait to write it. Well, this was a pleasure and thank you so much. Thank you for carving out this space and giving people the time and the opportunity to talk about these issues. I think it's really important. And I think the way that you do it in a very open-minded and caring and loving way is a really nice way of handling it. Thank you for your questions and for doing such a deep dive into my world and for this lovely interview.
It was really my pleasure. I'm truly honored. Take care of yourself and go give your kids big hugs and give your husband a break.
I will.
Thank you. You take care. All right. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
This is Rachel Steinman. For more information or to contact me with any questions, comments, or guest ideas, please check out rightnowrachel.com. That's right with a W. Thank you so much for listening, subscribing, and sharing, Dear Family. And if you found value in what you've just heard, I would love and so appreciate a great review on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. Until next time, I wish you love, happiness, and good mental health.